All right. I appreciate everybody that's on the call right now tonight. I'm just coming with a presentation dealing with biblical philosophy. If anybody's having difficulties hearing me, please inbox me, let me know so I can stop the recording. My basic stance tonight is just to help people to have a different outlook of reading their Bible. A lot of times we as people that are believers and those who are naysayers and even top scholars, we tend to go into the Bible and interpret it the way we want to, read it the way we want to, when really we should focus on how did the writers of the Bible want us to understand the message that they were conveying. So I'll be giving some philosophies dealing with certain scriptures that can open your mind to higher learning, and you can probably come up with some unique revelations on your own through the Most High's inspiration. And with that being said, Shabbat Shalom to my Mishpah Ka, Baruch At, Baruch Atah to my fellow men and my fellow sisters out there. Peace and health to you. Now, first, I want to start with something that is kind of controversial as far as when you're dealing with relationships in Yasharel. And just for the sake of time, I just wanted to know if everybody can still hear me out there.
We can hear you.
Okay, cool. Now, this is something that, you know, a lot of women and a lot of men probably deal with when it comes down to a relationship in Yasharel. The woman on her cycle. Now, just a few days ago, I have a group called Sarah's Daughters of Zion. One of the sisters actually put up an interesting post, and her post was a different outlook on the woman's cycle. In Yasharel, we know that a woman is to be separated from her husband and from the rest of the group for 7 days, as long as the cycle is on. Now, what's interesting is that the sister brought up some good points dealing with this typical matter. Now, some brothers ain't feeling that because you want to be around your woman 24/7, and that's definitely understandable. And, of course, the women want to be around their king as well. So, but now we have to look at some things that Most High has considered in actually creating man and woman. Man typically get breaks, as you see that in the Bible. But women, we really don't hear too many things about them having breaks. Now, women, cycle, that is also a weekly vacation away from the cooking, the cleaning, and the washing the kids and things of that nature. So we can conclude just by the sister's post, and which was a great point that she did make, that the Most High has made these features on the sisters for this particular reason, because as a woman of Yasharel, we constantly see that the women are the foundation of the nation. They do a lot of work. They take care of, you know, a lot of outsiders that come in. They're very generous. The hospitality is, very unique when you're dealing with Israel. And it's just funny that sometimes you need a break. And the funny part is this may be the time that the Most High has given you to actually have a break from those things, that you can relax from all manners of work when you're dealing on your cycle. And even sometimes with the men, you know, men like it 24/7 a lot, man. And sometimes, you know, sisters, man, it may get tiring. You know what I'm saying? Those are for the married sisters out there that know what I'm talking about. You can relate to this. And like I said, shout out to the sister for making that good point. Arielle, she made a very good point on that. So that's a philosophy right there that we can also keep in mind when we're reading the Bible, that we can look for certain things that may have more than just a unique definition to it. It can have more than a unique definition that is commonly known versus a unique definition that you can actually come up with when you're looking into certain things and aspects of why is this and why is that, when you start to question the actual scripture. Another thing I want to talk about is Yah's word, okay? And a lot of scholars, what they tend to do is they tend to find errors in the Bible. And then when they tend to find the errors in the Bible, the people that are against the Bible, they use those errors and they come to you with it, and they'll tell you that, you know, your God is mistaken, or, you know, your God is really not aware of the times, and your God is really not aware of what goes on in history because of certain things that may seem as though they're errors, and if they are errors, they'll still use these things against your faith. Now, I want to make this very clear because these are the facts that we're dealing with here. I want to make this statement. Yah's word is perfect, not man's writings. Yah's word is his message. Now, there's a difference between the writings in the Bible versus Yah's message in the Bible. And I think that we confuse that and we twist those together. We infuse those things. Then, down the line, if someone loses faith, it's always coming about because of a particular thing that's being said that Yah has nothing to do with. Yah's message is that all mankind come back to the one worship, the one true worship of himself. Okay, him being the eternal one, him being the father of all things that is created, the power, the substance, everything that is in existence today. That is Yah's message, all right? Now, when you have writings of particular people that are motivated by Yah, who are dealing with history, they can get things wrong. But the message is what is being conveyed and what is more important. And this is what the person that is inspired by Yah is actually focused on more. So regardless if we had prophets that were illiterate, regardless if we had prophets that wasn't aware of times or wasn't aware of chronology, their focus, their main focus, and the Bible tells us that our main focus is always to get the message of Yah across to the people, that they come back and that they worship him, okay, the true and right way, following his Torah, believing in his son, and other things that comes with it. So I wanted to make that statement very clear, and you can also go into 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 21, and it would tell you that the Mighty One moved upon the prophets, which this is what we call today in modern times divine inspiration. Now, divine inspiration, okay, is a real unique term, and I'll be reading off a definition for this term. And matter of fact, let me give you my own definition as far as my conclusion when it comes down to bringing somebody revelation, because this is what divine inspiration is all about, bringing about new revelation. And then I'll go and I'll read the secular definition for it. A theme, how to bring revelation to someone. How do you bring revelation to somebody? Now, what I've noticed in the Bible, and this is also touching on the fact that a lot of people say that the Bible plagiarized and copies from other major religions that predates its writings, which, yes, these other cultures definitely do predate the writings of the Bible, but the fact of, or the concept of saying plagiarizing or copying, okay, is a very thin line between those two. Copying is necessarily not plagiarizing to the ancients, because we have to understand that everybody was working within closed quarters, all right? So, what is one of the ways that you can bring revelation to someone? I'm going to point out some ways that the Bible brings revelation to people, and this is one of the ways. You take what's already known, and you bring them to the understanding of the concept of life, okay, to produce revelation, to promote higher learning. So basically what you see in the Bible where people say is plagiarizing and stealing other cultures, concepts, and understanding, that's not the case. The people in the Levant region are very familiar with stories, religion, and cosmology of their time. So they're going to use the things that other people can relate to get their message across, especially if you're dealing with outsiders, and especially if you're dealing with people that that traces their lineage back to Sumeria or Mesopotamia, to be exact, or even Egypt. Because we have to remember that the parents of the Israelites, according to the Bible, is Mesopotamia and Egypt. All right, we see the patterns, we see the migrations, and we see where Israel was birthed at, which was in Egypt, and we see, I'm sorry, where Israel was, where the conception of Israel was taking place at, which is Egypt, and with the and their birth out of Egypt, okay, back into these areas. So we have to understand that. Now, let me go to the definition, and then you can get a better understanding for yourself. And you can see that the Bible definitely does line up with the philosophy that I've basically put forth for you to understand. Divine inspiration.
that divine inspiration is the concept.
Now, we're not going to listen to the woman do it. I'm going to read it myself. Divine inspiration is a concept of a supernatural force, typically a deity, causing a person or people to experience a creative desire. Divine inspiration has been a commonly reported aspect of many religions for thousands of years. Divine inspiration is often closely tied to the concept of revelation, the belief in information being revealed or disclosed throughout communication with a deity or other supernatural entities or entity. Now, like I said, divine inspiration is basically dealing with revealing information, causing one to actually see something that they didn't normally see, or you coming about with some things that you didn't normally see, and now you can convey it, and you can go into deeper understanding about the particular subject. This is what the Bible promotes. I encourage everybody to look at the parallels with the Bible and other belief systems. The Bible is your foundation, but you have to understand that the Bible definitely does use different motifs and cosmologies and eschatology of other cultures because it is trying to convey an understanding to the people that are around them. And also they're using it to be unique and different. And they have to give people that message now understanding through something that they can understand, that they can relate to. All right. So let's go on down to the next one. Now, people tend to argue that the Bible is not a universal book, but the Bible, for the most part, actually makes that claim, and it really boasts in a real unique way that I say concerning writing particular things, dealing with other nations, that it is basically an overall book that's claiming that their deity, which is our Father, all right, which is, you know, our Creator, our Supreme One, and all praises to Yah, and all glory to Yah, that he is above all, he is the ruler of all, and he controls all. I'll quote a Psalms real quick. I don't actually have the Psalms on me right now, but I'm going to quote the Psalms, and I'm going to go into some scripture, and that's basically going to be it. But even David says that the Most High turns the heart of the king. That just doesn't mean for Israel. All right, we have to understand that. And certain scriptures that you too, and I'll expound on some, is Habakkuk chapter 1, verses 5 through 12. Now, what's unique about this, you see that in this passage, the Most High is raising another nation up to terrorize other nations. I will also quote from Paul. He says that, be at subject to the powers that be. See, this is not Brit Hadashah or what people call the New Testament concept. This is actually a understanding from Torah that Paul was issuing out to the people, because there's plenty of times where people wanted to fight against Nebuchadnezzar and Cyrus, but the Most High knew, just like Israel knew, and the prophets that knew what the Most High told him to tell the people, that they were going to take over. And a lot of people was trying to fight back and trying to, you know, be activists, and really they just should have just let them take them, and then, you know, no bloodshed would have been commenced. But that's another story, and getting into more detail with that part of history. But it still aids on to this subject here, that the Most High has raised these people up. When you go to Isaiah 45:1, which is very, 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 very interesting, at Jeremiah 43:10, very, very interesting. But the ones that are real unique, the ones that are very unique, is Ezekiel 31. And this is where I'm going to close at. Ezekiel 31 is dealing with the Garden of Elohim. And Egypt, okay, and Syria are included in this garden. And the way the Most High has caused his prophets to write about their magnificence, it's in a way where we see that the Most High is the one that crafted these nations to be who they are. These nations are his police, okay? And he uses these nations to war against one another to get certain things done within the earth for destiny. And you also see where the Most High will raise a particular person up that doesn't even believe in him, and they think that it is their God. We find all of these concepts in the Bible. We find these deeply rooted in the Bible and in the narrative. People neglect these details. and then they formulate their own opinion without having all of the evidence there to try to validate their claims that the Bible is false or is confusion that's there or is plagiarism that's there. Well, really, that's not the case. The Bible has more to offer. And on that note, if the Garden of Eden, okay, is being used to be correlated with Syria and also Egypt, that lets you know that Eden is way bigger than what a lot of the common folk believe. It said that Adam was placed in a particular location in the garden. That does not say, or that does not mean that the Garden of Eden was in Mesopotamia. It's bigger than that. All right, it's way bigger than that. And then you also have to deal with the concept and the understanding of the writing style where people will actually use acronyms. And there's nothing wrong with acronyms. These are people that are basically writing to you about their time, and they're giving you the places and they're giving you the names and the descriptions of what they can see in their time, talking about something that happened way before their time. This is what the acronym is, and it's very useful. It's just like if there was a street out here named Jameson Street before I moved here, but they turned it to Ellis Street. Now, Ellis Street has not changed, only the name, and I'm giving you the description, but I'm using the name that I know today. And when you go into history and you find the actual name of Ellis Street, it shouldn't drive one to say that the Bible doesn't know what it's talking about and, you know, it's this story was made up at this time. So those are the things I really wanted to bring out tonight. It wasn't really anything too long, but these are key things that you can use to come up with revelations and to get closer to the Father, to ask the Father what information that we overlook that you could probably bring out and help people fix themselves and help people stay in this Bible. Help these people keep their faith. And that's basically what this recording is about. And I appreciate everybody out there that was listening in. What I'm going to do right now, I'm going to stop the recording. I really want everybody to go back and listen to what I was saying, the concepts and the philosophies that I was bringing out, and read for yourself. Read some of the scriptures and see what you can come up with. All right, and remember, it's not your interpretation into what you want to believe. It's what the Bible writers wanted you to believe. It's what the Bible writers wanted you to understand about what they were writing. And we have to go a little bit more deeper. But with that being said, Shabbat Shalom, Mishpacha, Baruch to everybody, to all, and Lahitrayot.